All right, well, welcome to the Kumara Center for Spiritual Awareness. I'm Devin Nair. I'm here with Shusara Kumara, the founder and visionary for the Kumara Center. And this will be the second of our interviews with Shusara, kind of like a fireside chat, where the first one we talked a little bit about an introduction to what Kumara Center is, and the work, some of the terms that we use. But in this one, Shusara has no idea what I'm going to ask her. I went back and read through my initial journals when I started working with Shusara. And when I was really seeking hard for something, didn't know what it was, and I was going through that whole kind of a painful process of finding it and finding myself, and I started to uncover what some of the questions for me were at that time. And so that's some of the stuff I want to throw out to see if it's helpful to others.
Okay.
To see if these questions arise for other people, and maybe it helps answer some stuff. So we talked a little bit last time, just a sort of an introduction to the Kumara Center for Spiritual Awareness and Create a New World. A little bit, we touched on it. And then we started sort of talking about like the work, what does it mean, the processing work, and some of the terms that we hear out there, like non-polarity or non-duality, mm-hmm. or dissolution work, dissolution of the ego. We kind of use some of the big terms that are thrown around that are really confusing when you're kind of beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So we talked a little bit about that, but this time when I was going back through my journal and reading, I remember some of the big things that hit me right out of the gate. I've been searching for who am I, what am I, because there's more. I have no idea what it is, but I know it's not this.
Right.
And not that I was trying to negate this or dishonor it or disrespect it, but it was like I was waking up and didn't have any idea what was going on. It was kind of like that. And I was like, wait a minute, there's more to me. It's not just this, but I have no idea. So, and then I remember working with you, and we talked about dissolution of the personal self, and you were like, you know, you were throwing things out to me that were making such profound statements to me. And you'll have to jump in if I say it in a way that's not clear for everybody listening, but when I was going back through my reading, and you were saying, you're not the body, you're not this that you're labeling yourself to be, the failure, the bad mother, the person who can't take care of themselves. It was all these things I truly felt that I was, and that was me. And you were telling me, this is not you, that's not you. And so I remember one of the big questions, and this is the first one I want to start out with, was, well, if I'm not this stuff that I don't like, that I feel that I am, then who the hell am I? Mm-hmm. What am I?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to start there, because I think sometimes, and I've also been, just as a little side note, I noticed that a lot of the spiritual teachers today in their work, and a lot of beautiful stuff, but they say a lot of what is not,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't give a person anywhere to go with what they are, or,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? So it kind of leaves a gap. So you're going, well, if I'm not this, and this is not real, and this, so you're going, well, what the hell? You know? So I was very frustrated in the beginning with that. So I'd like to throw that out there. So who are we? What are we? What's the truth that we're really seeking, but really don't know that we're seeking?
Okay, so you asked me the easiest question in the world.
Awesome.
And the answer is, you are God. Next.
Expand on that, please.
Next. Because that's it. So you, your divine nature, what you are, you know, you're, and you will hear it said out there very commonly, kind of your spirit having a physical experience, and it's very true. On another level, the physical experience itself isn't even real. It truly is not, and that's something that is experiential, but that comes far, far later. So I won't get into that, but it needs to be said, because even though people do deep spiritual work, they still hold this as real. I can touch it, I can feel it, I can think it, I can, you know, whatever, I can say it, and it makes it real, and it's not real. The reality is that once consciousness completely transcends this reality altogether, it's gone. No memory, no anything. It's just gone until consciousness reappears seemingly here. So, and that is truth. But it's experiential, and it takes a lot of time to get to that place, which is kind of funny because time is a creation of mind too. everything I say, you know, we can just expand on. But so your divine nature as spirit itself is, and we use a group of words for this, and we use it all the time for here at the Kumara Center. So you are beginningless, endless, formless, single, being, knowledge, bliss. And those are kind of the, you know, it's very difficult to use language, period, to point to anything because language is polarized. So in using language, you can only point to things that are conceptual. And of course, you as divine spirit itself is outside of concept. So how do you use concept to get to what's outside of concept? And ultimately, you can't. You just can't. But you can use conceptual things to point deeper toward what lies outside of it. So when we have to do that. So those words, beginningless, endless, formless, single, being, knowledge, bliss, most closely resemble that which you truly are. You are infinite. I mean, you are beginningless and endless. So, you know, as a beautiful contemplative exercise, it's wonderful just to sit in these words and to really allow yourself to go, what does that mean? I don't have a beginning. You know, I don't have a beginning. And if you really sit with that, that in itself will allow for an expansion of consciousness that you were never born, you will never die, beginningless and endless, just absolutely infinite, formless without form. Truly without form, single because there is only one and it's the one that appears as all, right? And you are that, so single. Being itself, so you are not a doer, you are beingness, you know. Knowledge, so knowledge not from the space of the mind that mind thinks if I read something and now I can remember it, it's knowledge. No, knowledge is not that. Knowledge is instantaneous knowing. In any circumstance when it's needed, that's knowledge, and that is very natural to your beingness. And I've had, you know, as a, just an example, I've had times where I've been sitting in session and something comes through and out of this mouth and there's a witness back there that watches and goes, oh, I never heard that before. But it's not to be questioned because I know where it comes from and it needed to be present and there it was. And similarly, a lot of times people will actually experience a level of knowing, but they think of it as their memory. So they'll attribute it to, I have a really good memory. But the reality is the deeper you go into dissolution, the less quote unquote memory you carry, and you know that well. So you find that it's very difficult to remember things that happened, you know, 20 minutes ago, 2 days ago, 10 years ago. But in a moment of knowing in a situation, you will be amazed at the recall that you have and the clarity with which you remember any given situation. You'll remember every little detail about it, but it's not memory, it's your knowing coming forward when needed. So, and then the last one is bliss. And bliss is kind of hard to, you know, as humans we have an idea of what bliss is, and the expectation behind what bliss is, I think is one of those things that trips a lot of people up, because to sit and say samadhi, which is bliss and meditation, people have some kind of concept of what that means. And really it's just it's the state of being outside of the confliction of the personal self. You know, it is bliss. Mm-hmm. There's no tugging, there's no pulling, there's, you know, just call it peace is not even adequate. It doesn't mean you're constantly in this state of what you think of as joy, and, you know, because we have an idea of what that means too, and it's not necessarily that either. It's kind of emotionless, really. So that's what you are, and that's the beauty of doing very deep work. Is the point is, and our kind of our tagline for the Kumara Center is rediscover your divine nature, because that's exactly what we're here to help people do. You know, it didn't go anywhere. You aren't not that. You've always been that. You can't not be it. It's just there's an identification that's been going on with consciousness as you that perceives itself to be separate from all the things that it truly is. And so the point in doing this work on this planet is to help bring people into greater alignment with that which they are, you know, to rediscover that thing. And to say rediscover is not really adequate either, but it's the closest thing I could come up with that seems to point to what it is that we're doing. So does that, do you think yes. that answers that? Okay, good.
No, that's good.
So that's good. That's where I wanted to start. So then what happens? So that's what we are. That's our true divine essence and nature. But then we sit and look at ourselves here and we don't remember that. We can't seem to find that. We're like, okay, that feels right. Mm-hmm. So when you say it, I'm like, something inside's going, yes, yes, yes. But we don't seem to experience that.
Right.
We actually seem to experience the antithesis of that. Why is that? What happens?
It can't. The fundamental issue is that the personal self, the being that you think you are here in form, can't, is not the one that experiences pure awareness. It isn't. It can't make the leap. So there's no way out for the ego. There's no way out of the struggle, the battle between this is what I think I am, this is what you tell me I am, so this is what I, and I want that, and I'm going to take all the steps to get to it. But holding just that is necessary. And remember, and I'm very particular about this, I don't polarize over anything, so I wouldn't say it doesn't have its place. It does have its place. If it wasn't for this, you know, the desire itself to reawaken, we'll say, you'd never do it. But even the desire has to be dropped at a certain point, mm-hmm. you see, because through the state of desire, you can't attain it. And the one that is it, there's no attainment there. And it's very hard to, that sounds a little, it'll sound contradictory, but there's no other way to speak it. And anybody who's had the experience knows exactly what I'm saying, because the one that is it is not the one that's going through the steps to become it. You know, the sense of becoming in itself is a trap. It is a trap, but it's a necessary trap on the journey, because without it, you know, outside of pure grace and having an individual who's done so much work in other lifetimes that they're ready at this point to have, you know, like an experience of an Eckhart Tolle or a Byron Katie, where it was like this automatic boom, you know, awakening. That's very rare. Not that it can't happen, but it is rare. So those people didn't necessarily need to do the steps in this lifetime, but it doesn't mean they haven't done it. So for everybody else, it is necessary. There is a what I want to become and the work that I have to do, you know, and all of that is very necessary. And the tricky thing for me as a guide is to constantly, this is what I have to do, I constantly have to work with a seeker from both spots, you know, from the spot of you, what you appear to be doing in your life, and the where you're placing your attention and how you're looking at thought and emotion and getting into it and walking through it and all of that is very, very important to the journey. But simultaneously, I have to keep presenting truth, you know, and that truth can seem to contradict with the other, but I have to present both, because in order to journey to the point where the last step is what's remaining, you can't get there without having truth constantly brought to your awareness, mm-hmm. because the ego battles it so much, it just kind of has to be brought in all the time, you know. Mm-hmm. You're not the body. I mean, that's just one very basic truth that's really hard to drop. And until you go deep enough into meditation where you completely lose the body, that would seem, you know, crazy.
Yeah. For sure.
Want to bet I'm not my body? Yeah, right?
Yeah, I can feel it.
That's right. But deep enough in meditation, the body's gone. Mm-hmm. And so once you've had that experience and you come back out, there's no more questioning. Mm-hmm. See, it is. It's experiential. Every step is fully experiential. Until you've had the actual experience of it, it won't be true for you. you know, it can be, you can hold it as a truth on a mental level, and that has its place as well, but it won't be true for you, you know, until you experience it. So that's the goal.
And I can completely relate. The seeking and the striving, and I wanted so bad to get there. And there were moments where all of a sudden I would just be like, oh. And I would have that experience that took hold, and it kind of seemed anticlimactic. I was like, I expected bells and whistles, and, you know. But then I was just all of a sudden in this very peaceful place, and it did feel like bliss. I was like, oh, it was beautiful. But I couldn't have told you how I got there, or, you know. So I do remember what that was like. The really wanting and striving with all that I am for something greater, something better, something more that was more accurately me, you know, when you're first starting out. So that completely makes sense. So another question I wanted to ask that was really confusing me in the beginning was when you started teaching me, you know, reminding me about all of this stuff that I had forgotten completely. Like, at first when you were saying it, my mind was going, that does not compute. That's like another language to me. Mm-hmm. But something inside was going, no, we know this, you know. So, but another one was when you and your guide, Atona, would talk about the illumined worlds. And that used to blow my mind, too, because I was like, well, this is the world, right? This is like the only world, right? Like, this is, because that's what I was taught, you know. And that used to kind of throw my mind. Can you speak about that a little bit so that people get an idea of what there is beyond this? So, because a lot of us have been taught, this is it. There's one planet.
Right.
You've got one life. That's it. We only want to go to how crazy it sounds with all of that. But what else is there? Like, so we now you've reminded us of what we truly are. Mm-hmm. Kind of give us an idea of what else there is.
Okay, and I will purposefully keep it very simple and very brief, and there's a reason. Very specifically because knowledge of the illumined worlds can actually act as a block for a seeker. Mm-hmm. So I really don't dwell on it because, again, even that is experiential, and it is it is true. But it can act as a block, so I have to be careful. But I will speak to it. So first off, just everyone does need the understanding, and luckily now we're in a world where a lot of people get it. You know, the universe is teeming with life. You know, there's like nowhere that life isn't, really. So everyone just first needs to wake up to that, just on a very mundane level. Beyond that, there are... You know, space is an illusion, time is an illusion, and within the multiverse, there are layers of dimensions, you know, and they aren't out there. It's actually all within the essence of what the Creator is, but all kind of stacked up. So everything's here. I mean, there's truly nowhere to go. So in the expansion of consciousness, when it reaches a point of what most people would term enlightenment, it recognizes itself. The words aren't good. There's no way to word it accurately. The experience is of pure awareness, and pure awareness is what I pointed to earlier: beginningless, endless, formless, single being, knowledge bliss. So if you ever hear of, it was funny when I started my journey, I reached a point where I had this huge fear of, what did I call it? Floating in the sea of nothingness, I think is what I called it. I was petrified, but that is it. The in that state, there is no other, there is no me, there is none of it. It's this, the undifferentiated totality, and that is accurate. So that's where a lot of traditions stop off. That's their stopping off point. Mm-hmm. And that's beautiful. But there is more past that. And past that, if you think of it this way, that anything that can be experienced is happening because it's a projection of the one mind being God. Mm-hmm. Okay. All the projections. So we can call this a projection. It's just that this isn't a real projection. This is a dreamlike projection. Well, beyond that, there is individuation without separation, which means that God as itself individuated itself to experience itself in many forms and in many ways. This is outside of this reality that everyone thinks they're living in right now. And within that, there is form. It's very subtle form, but there is form. There is a sense of kind of you and me. But the difference is that here, the you and me keeps us separate. Whereas in that level of projection, the you and me is the one. That's the only way I can word it, because I wouldn't ever look at you and see you as outside of myself. Mm-hmm. But I don't see myself as me either. We're all the same. But it allows for different, you know, experiences to be had and stories to be told and, you know, adventures to go on and, you know, whatever. And those are what I would term the illumined worlds. And that's something that in the process of dissolution, at a certain point, you've done enough and consciousness has expanded back again enough to allow you to start to peek into them. So you can start having, in like meditation or even in dream state, have glimpses into what I term the illumined worlds. You certainly work in them all the time when the body's sleeping, all the time, because you return to source and you will return to wherever you kind of last came from, the aspect of you that is here now. To do your work, and and then at a certain point, when it's kind of when the awakening is complete here, then you walk again in them, mm-hmm. consciously and by choice, you know. But there's a whole level of stuff going on where, you know, just because you aren't having experiences that you can look to and say, you know, oh, I did that, or I remember that, or whatever, it doesn't mean it's not happening. And that's something that for a lot of people on the planet, it's a little frustrating on the end of, well, wouldn't it be nice if we all, you know, remembered when we're the body sleeping and we remember we're off, you know, on ship someplace or we're on whatever other planet and with our families and this and that. And yes, wouldn't it? But I think that what happens is, you know, you're veiled here, and you have to remember that you're veiled here for a very good reason. It's a very compassionate reason. If you were, if the average person was capable of, say, just remembering all of their physical lifetimes, they probably wouldn't be able to function, because if they actually had total recall of all the horrendous things that they've done personally or things that had been done to them, I mean, you couldn't even function. So that veiling is beneficial, truly. Everyone's always so excited to get, you know, memory of their former lives. It's like, why? Really? You're not missing anything. But from the other level, same thing. Because if you could imagine from the state you're capable of, if you could imagine the most perfect an expansive and illuminated feeling that you could possibly have, like the greatest love you've ever felt in your world, and expand it out. If you could imagine that being your natural beingness, who you are in the illumined worlds, and then see the energetic difference between that state of consciousness and the one that's held here, you would recognize that it is compassion that keeps you veiled, because to experience that drop over and over again, well, it is the imprint, yeah? And it would be just traumatic, yeah, and excruciatingly painful, truly, yeah. So, you know, take heart. It doesn't mean that you aren't having experiences, because really everyone on the planet is in initiation. Everyone here now is here now for a very good reason, and it's perfect timing for them. And everyone is doing their work. you know, in some form or others. It's just some people are very drawn to do very specific work, like what we do at Kumara mm-hmm. Center, because it's very specific timing for them. But everybody's doing their work. So, you know, people all over the world are having experiences, but you just don't remember it, you know. So if you're one of those people where you're all frustrated, I don't know what's happening and I don't feel like I'm getting anywhere, just you need to cut yourself a little slack and recognize that things are happening that are in your highest good. Absolutely. There's nothing that's happening that's not in your highest good, ever. Mm. Ever. No matter how hard it is to walk. So, just hold that. Write it down on a sticky note or something. Whatever's happening is happening in my highest good, you know, and have faith in that, because it's the truth.
So my next question then, naturally, just from where you went, it's naturally going to feed into that. So if there are people out there and you're saying these things, then they're going, okay, that feels, what she's saying feels right to me, but I don't know where to start. I don't know how to begin to find an experience of that. Mm-hmm. So, of course, I have opinions about things that Kumara Center that they could engage in, but I'd like to hear from you. Where do people start when they recognize what you're saying, but their experience is not of that right now, and that starts to really bring up questions for them? Well, now the brain's going, oh my God, like, I have all this information, you know. So mm-hmm. if a person's going, I don't know where to start now, mm-hmm. what's the best place, what's the best way for them to start? Or best place for them to start, or what would they do? What do you think they can do?
Well, so I would say for anybody who's wanting to become more conscious, we'll just start with that.
Okay.
Regardless of you finding a teacher or a guide or a program or whatever, if you just want to begin the journey of becoming more conscious in your life, it has to start first with making the choice to do it. It has to be a conscious choice, and it needs to be a deliberate one. So it's not something you go into lightly, kind of like a New Year's resolution, right? Yeah. If you're serious, it means you're going to take it seriously. And we laugh, but you know, you'd be surprised how many people I've worked with who, I mean, I can be with them for years and I'm still watching them play with it, mm-hmm. you know, and you're like, so when are you going to get serious, you know? And it happens all the time. You have to meditate. So if you have never meditated, you need to start, because that is a key component for any path you're on. It has to be, because it's the only thing that's going to show you you're not your physical form is meditation. And there's a whole lot of work that happens during meditation that I won't talk about, but it's very important to doing dissolution work. So if it means you just start with, you know, committing to 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes before bed, that's great, but you want to work yourself up to a place where you can really sit in the stillness for more extended periods. That in and of itself will help move things along. And the other component that is key is for you to really work at becoming more of an observer in your own life. It is a key component. So you have to recognize that the life that you're living, you're addicted to the states of mind that you experience. You're addicted to the stories that, and the place you hold yourself within the stories, and all of that. And you have to start to pull back. There's something that we call the objective observer. And the objective observer is capable of watching everything that's going on without having a story at all. It just watches. And that's a component that is very necessary for anybody who is doing spiritual work, so that you can begin to see deeper into what's perpetuating the stories. You know, the reason things happen in your life the way they happen is because you've brought them to yourself to happen exactly the way that they're happening, because it's feeding a story, and it's a story that you believe to be true, and that on probably an unconscious level, you feel that you need to experience over and over and over again. And people will say, well, that's not true. I have these terrible things that happen to me. Why would I want that? And it's not that you're consciously bringing it to yourself, but you've held yourself in resistance to something that is now creating the condition where it has to come to you in material form in the manifest world, because the manifest world is just a reflection of the inner world. That's all it is. It's the same exact thing, two sides of the same coin. So whatever is held unconsciously in the inner world has to manifest, and it manifests out here so that you can actually have to deal with it. Because people don't want to go in and deal with things, you know, unless they're forced to. So becoming more objective in your life and starting to really question, you know, something happened and I got angry, to take the time to go, why did that bother me so much? I mean, even that seems like, well, for my students, it's like, well, we do that all day long. You know, every thought, it's like, why did that happen? And why, you know, but for the average person, that's a big deal. Why would I question why I got angry? I deserve to be angry. Well, did I deserve to be angry? You know, mm-hmm. Why did it get to you so badly? And to really start looking and rooting out what's going on there. And being willing, honest with yourself, and willing to accept when you see that it's something that's really not pretty to look at, you know. Because that's the reality. The reality is that the personal self that is exhibited in every person, but is the same personal self, that program, you know, it's all of it. It's beautiful and it's horrendous. It's all of it. And all of it has to be here because we live in a polarized reality. So everything has to be represented here. You're not going to change this reality into something, some kind of nirvana. That's not going to happen. But it doesn't need to. What it needs to be. Mm-hmm. In order for you to experience nirvana, you're not going to be experiencing it through 3D. You won't, because this is exactly what it is, and there is no changing it. To experience something outside of it only means you need to see through what this is, because until you see through it, it holds you, you know, you're shackled to it. Mm-hmm. But in seeing through it, then it opens up a whole other realities to you, that you can now appear to be in the same place but experience a much different reality. Yeah. So that's where I would start, you know, outside of, you know, anyone who wants to do work with the Kumara Center, but just for a general seeker, that's where I start. And it's really, the work is internal, it's all internal. And while it is necessary, this is a tricky point. So many teachers out there are people who are, I don't know, just like well-known in the spiritual world or whatever. Mm-hmm. You hear them say, you know, all the work is done within and you don't need a teacher and you don't need whatever. Is it true? Yes and no. Mm-hmm. You know, because the bottom line is it all comes from within. It has to, because like I've said, it's fully experiential. So the only way it can happen ultimately is through that. However, you're not going to pick someone just off the street and expect them, that individual that's functioning on an unconscious level 99.99% of the time, you're not going to take that person and have them move quickly into, you know, transcendent experiences without having some guidance. Mm-hmm. You know, it just isn't going to happen. Now, you will be led to the one that is the most, the best fit for you at any given time. And at some point you hopefully will outgrow that level of teaching, you know. And all the teaching that's on the planet, it's all perfectly placed and everything has its purpose and it's perfect for what it is. So if you're led, go, you know, but don't make it your I don't know what you'd call it. It's like, that's not the end all.
Like your new religion.
That's right. That's right. Yes. Yeah. Because every teaching will have a stopping point, meaning that at some point, regardless of what path you're following, it doesn't matter. At some point, even whatever belief it is you're holding about it, right? Whatever belief it is, it has to be dropped. It has to. It doesn't mean it negates the work. It doesn't mean you stop following the work. Mm-hmm. But the necessity you feel toward that aspect of it and what it brings you to has to be dropped, mm-hmm. right? So for whatever it is, let's say it's people who, you know, follow the sound current. Well, beautiful, because that can take you to experiences completely outside the senses. Well, that's fantastic. But if your belief is that you have to, you know, be in meditation and do a mantra, right? guess what? At some point, that's going to be the piece that's keeping you from going beyond, right? Mm-hmm. And it's the same could be true of anything. You could take the work that we do. Processing work is a huge component of what we do, but it's not an end-all, right? And I have seen students who are so attached to their processing work that they process everything when they're already at a point where they don't need to anymore, you know? But it's, you know, they were good at it, and they see a lot, and they see what it does, but there's a next step for them, and it's not by me telling them, stop processing now. They have to do it on their own, right? So if the belief is there that I have to do this, now that's the piece that's going to keep you stuck. And it's true of all, whatever the path is, you know, and my path is no different. It's true of all of them. So whatever it is you're drawn to, you know, do it, enjoy it. If you feel like, you know, if it's pushing you and you feel some resistance, that's not a bad thing. You know, find out why. If you feel like it just doesn't resonate at all with you, well, then it's not for you, and that's fine too. Mm-hmm. And I would be the first to say that about our work. I mean, there aren't a lot of people who are ready to do the level of work that I personally mm-hmm. do with people as a guide. Well, you've walked it, right? Yes. You've seen how many people come in and make it to one satsang and never come back, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've had many experiences where someone comes in and they ask me a question. I give them truth, and they don't like what they hear, so they don't come back. And that's fine. And the reality of it is that I pushed them to look at something that they're just not ready to see through yet, right? And that's cool. You know, it did its thing, and now they'll move on and do what they need to do for them. But if you recognize yourself as a real seeker, I mean a real seeker, where you have this burning desire for truth, that's the best way for me to word it, that you just feel in your core, and you will not rest until you've gotten it, then the path that we walk is at that level, you know. And there are others, certainly, but I will say that the work that we do here is very unique, because it does move beyond where almost every single other path on the planet goes. It really does. Yeah. Yeah. And I don't speak to that a whole lot, but it does. That is the reality of it. Yeah. For those who are willing to really walk it. Yeah. Yeah. There's nothing I can do for you, right?
Right. So what I want to say next is that I have found, you know, I was, and still am, always in that kind of a desperate search for truth. Like there's the heart or whatever in me, it longs to just know the truth, whatever that is. So even if it's painful and if it hurts, mm-hmm. or my mm-hmm. mind goes, I can't compute, I'm like, no, I still got to know it. But in doing the work with you, so when I was, you know, working with you intensely through the week,
yeah.
At first, I didn't see how I was searching for the truth, yet I didn't see how it was going to change my everyday life in such a beautiful and practical, tangible way. Like, that's not what I was looking for. That was like a side benefit. So I was like, oh, nice. So I want people to understand that part, that it's not just about being a seeker and being in meditation and dissolving the ego. Those are beautiful, absolute beautiful things in the work. But in doing that, there are so many other benefits.
Yes.
And sometimes when I talk to my friends or whatever, and I'm explaining to them my journey, what I've been through, and they're like, oh, that sounds hard, I don't know. I'm like, but it changes your life in such beautiful, practical, tangible ways. Mm-hmm. So even if you're like, well, I'm not the hardcore seeker who wants to sit in meditation, and I'm not sure if I'm quite ready for that yet, mm-hmm. the work still is so meaningful. It's so beautiful. Mm-hmm. So can you help people understand how usable it is just on an everyday?
Well, sure. I mean, from a very basic place, the point of the work is to release all of the constriction that's held around the heart. I mean, that's truly what's going on when you do deep dissolution work. So the heart is your divine essence, right? And it's in this constant expansion mode. That's all it knows. Beginningless, endless, right? So that's what it does. And the thing is that all of the concepts and the beliefs and the desires and the attachments that hold the personal self in place actually work to constrict the heart space. So it's not that the heart stops expanding, it's just that you don't experience it, because all you do experience is the constriction. So what's pushing down on the heart is what you experience every day. That's where, you know, you experience anger and frustration and jealousy and guilt and all of this stuff. So it can say, you know, like you have friends, oh, that looks really hard. It is really hard. Of course it is. But anything, you know, worth doing is worth walking through some difficulty to do. And this isn't any different. If you want your life to be easy, this work is not for you. I mean, it just isn't. But you have to recognize that you may have it easy right now. Maybe life is pretty good. You've got a decent job. You're making good money. You've got a great relationship and a nice house, and a new car every 3 years, you know. And that's great. But if you believe in reincarnation, you know, there's no telling what it's going to be next time. Well, that's not true. But we'll just say at some point you are going to live. You're going to live out the other side of everything that you're consciously holding, you know, as polarized. So great for this lifetime. But if you think further, that's where those people, it takes that to go, oh. Because some people really are locked into, I really don't care if there's life after death. I don't care about any of it. I'm just going to live this lifetime. Perfect, you know, live this lifetime and have at it and love it and enjoy it. And maybe next go around, you'll decide that it's worth deeper, you know, work. For people who do recognize, and for most of the people who come here, they recognize this, like, sense of, I'm just so over it. Right? Yeah. That's right. It's like, I just want to be done. And that's that level of awareness that you have that knows that it's been running the same cycle over and over and over, but this isn't real. This isn't who we are, you know? And you get to a place where you're like, I'm done with it. So whatever it is I need to do, can you please show it to me so I can get off of the hamster wheel? So the work, it's the beautiful thing of it is that it is psychological work, right? It is. And there's a big component of it that I deal with people where, you know, I could be your psychiatrist because I have that level of understanding. But it takes things that a psychiatrist would look at and would say, okay, so here's the issue. What the psychiatrist is going to do is to help you basically repolarize so that you're sitting in this spot of polarization and you're miserable, and they're going to help you shift yourself over here so you're polarized on this side and you're not miserable or less miserable. Mm-hmm. And what I'm going to do with you is I'm going to get you to see all of that, but I'm going to help you come down right through the middle and see through the whole story and recognize that you're not the story. You know, that the story has no power over you. You aren't that. You can't be that. But in order to get there, you have to walk through that. And that is hard, right? Because the places where, let's say, you know, there are places where if you consciously say, I'm not racist, guess what? There's another aspect that's unconscious that is racist, right? Mm-hmm. And if you hold racism as a bad thing, you're not going to want to start to see where it crops up in you. Yeah. You're not going to want to see it. It's painful. Of course it's painful, but the only way to dissolve the whole construct of these, you know, polarized concepts is to actually own both sides, which means I see myself as the one who's not racist, and here's where I can see where I have been. Let's say I recognized I was walking down the street and, let's see, for me, so this large black man's coming at me down the street, and I recognized that when he got close to me, I clutched my purse tighter, right? Mm-hmm. And so then what happens there is mind wants to justify, well, I did it because he was a big guy. It had nothing to do with him being black, mm-hmm. right? And sure. So you have to get in at that level and go, really? Really? Let's be honest here. right? Mm-hmm. And when you can really get in and go, oh, wow, there is. There's this thing that sits there. And where did I pick that up? Because it was learned. You know, it was learned. So now we get in and we can see where things are learned. And then we see that it's just a pattern of you learn something, you take it on, it's imprinted in consciousness, and then you go and perpetuate it out there. And it's just, you know, generation after generation after generation. So on the level of it being difficult, it is. But at a certain point, it's really not anymore. Because when it stops feeling so personal, which is ultimately what happens, it just stops feeling personal. Now you're objective, and you're looking for it, right? Yeah. And you're like, ooh, I recognized that. What was that all about? And now you're not like, I don't want to see that. I don't want to get in there and root it out and, you know, deal with whatever misery it's going to bring me. You're like, ooh, let's find it, right? Which can seem a little sadistic. But the beautiful thing is you find it, and you recognize where really what's going on is you're withholding your heart from people in the world, and usually mostly with the people you care about the most, you know? And you recognize in doing your work how this whole identification with the story of me has left me in a position where I perpetually hurt people, and it's not conscious, you know, it's a very innocent thing, but I perpetually hurt people that I love, you know, and I start to recognize it, and it does feel terrible, because when it hits your heart chakra, and you realize, oh my gosh, I can't believe I did that to him or to her, then now you can make it right. It allows you to see from a completely different level, and you can go make it right with the person, you know, and humility. And such healing can come from that. It's just, you know, and you've walked that. It's an amazing, amazing experience. And now that you've walked that, you can't undo it. You've had the experience, and now you function from a completely different place in your life. So those experiences don't get set up anymore. You know, they just don't. So at a certain point of doing deeper work, you really are moving through the world in such a place of peace. Now, it doesn't mean nothing ever pops up, because of course it does. You're here to master the world. So of course it'll pop up, but you don't run from the challenge anymore. You know, you aren't frightened by having to go into something new or something scary. You're like, okay, we'll take it as it comes, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's very, very empowering that way. Does that answer that?
It does. Enough? That was beautiful. And it also helps, like from my experience, was I not only was I hurting other people, but I was hurting myself.
Yes.
Oh, because yeah. I would project rejection was going to come or whatever. So I would withhold my love that I wanted to give freely, but it would hurt me, because at the end of the day, I was like, I have no friends. I'm not loved. Because I was cutting that off. I was like, no, I'm just all from a story.
Yep, that's right.
And it's nice when I, in the moments where I feel like I can really live open-hearted and not need anything, and I like being able to give love that freely and not needing anything. I don't need the other person to reciprocate in kind.
Right,
that's
right.
Lovely.
It is.
And then it's nice when people come to me and go, thank you for being so patient with me or so loving when I was so ugly. But I don't see them as being ugly. Like,
right.
So that's been nice for me. It's just to feel as if I can truly give when I just wanted to give all along.
Yes.
But I just couldn't because I didn't know how.
Right.
Or didn't remember how.
Right.
So that feels really good. Just the giving feels really good because it feels so natural.
And it is. And the thing is, you know, the heart is completely impersonal. And everyone, you know, the concept is that the heart is so personal. Yeah. And it's not. Not at all. It's all of the polarized stuff is what's personal, you know. And so when you're functioning from the heart, it doesn't take anything personally, period. And so you can have someone who's, you know, on a tirade or whatever, and maybe it's directed at you, and it doesn't even affect you.
Yeah.
And you really can see the person from a place of compassion, thinking, okay, you know, like if I was in his shoes, I'd probably be yelling at me too, without it getting me all worked up, feeling like I have to defend myself or whatever, you know. And then it gives you the capacity to just stand in your knowing, and you can maybe say, you know, if that's what happened and that's how you read my actions, I apologize. It was not my intent to do that. Mm-hmm. I promise. That was not my intent. And you know that to be true for you, and you leave it at that. Now the person's going to do whatever they want with it. Mm-hmm. They may get angrier, and that's fine. Or they may actually have a moment where they can recognize, oh, wow, if you didn't intend to hurt me, and I'm here I am, you know, lashing out at you, and that's not okay. And I've had personal experience with that over and over and over again, where you, just you being able to be centered is enough that now what you can reflect back kind of forces the other person to see it, you know. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing. But the heart, you know, it is completely impersonal. Mm-hmm. And completely and utterly vulnerable. You know, which scares people. Mm-hmm. Because they think, oh, you know, I've had my heart broken. You can't have your heart broken. Mm-hmm. Impossible. The heart is the heart, and it is unchanging. You know, it's real. Anything else isn't real around it. That's what we're here to do. Let's find what's not real, right? And let's shake it off. I mean, that's what we're here to do.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the, and I'm not good at remembering quotes because the memory is, you know, it's not good. But I think there's a quote or a line in A Course in Miracles where Jesus says, the goal is not to find love, it's to find all the obstacles you've set up to love. Mm. Something, that's a loose paraphrase. Mm-hmm. But that's what reminds me of, mm-hmm. is that you are love. You know, I am love. It's to find where all these little places are that I've set up that keeps me from letting that flow so freely.
That's right. That's right. And it is all internal, mm-hmm. all of it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's not, if you feel oppressed by another individual, it makes it easy for you to keep holding it out here. The oppression's coming from within, mm-hmm. you know. And that's the bottom line of all of it. It requires that level of being able to stop holding the focus out here and to bring it here. Use the external to show you the things that you thus far have not really been willing to look at. Mm-hmm. You know, utilize it that way because it's perfect for that. But then rather than blaming out, bring it here and find it here, mm-hmm. you know, and it'll give you that right there, will give you a different perspective altogether. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And for me, there were so many more benefits. Like just everyday life is so much easier.
Yes.
I'm not stressed.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, my life is busy, it's very busy. But I'm not stressed. I don't get worried if I miss something or make a mistake.
Right.
I own it and go, I completely missed that. I'm so sorry. You know, there's such a sense of, and empowerment seems weird, like I'm trying to empower the personal self. But there's just such a sense of empowerment, like being able to move through life every day with grace and just go, mm-hmm. everything's good. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not always pretty, but it's good.
Yeah, yeah.
And to be at peace with people and not get set off by things. I don't have road rage. I don't get angry. It's really nice to have more peace and just ease and being able to really observe things and move in the moment with that thing instead of always feeling like I gotta be on top of things. Right. There's just so many other benefits.
Yeah. I'd call it liberation.
Yes. Yes.
Because to me, that's, it really speaks to all of it. That up until you've done enough work, you are enslaved in a program, and that the program is me. And you really are enslaved in it, and you can't see outside of it, and it literally is functioning on an unconscious level all the time. And through enough work, there is this liberation that happens when you recognize you are not your story, and you start living in the world from outside of any story. And that's exactly what you're speaking to. You know, that, yes, so a piece of work comes my way and I miss the deadline. Well, the story used to dictate that I would feel ashamed of myself, that I would feel guilty and terrible and I'd have to apologize profusely. Or the story may dictate that my shame would lead me to look for a reason to blame someone else for the fact that, or hide it. Yeah, all of that. Whereas now, if there's no story and the deadline is missed, I can apologize for missing the deadline, but I'm not going to harbor shame or guilt. I'll make it right to the best of my ability and move on. And it is that simple. I mean, it's that simple. You know, learn from the experience, walk out of it with greater wisdom, and there you go. And that's all life has to be. It doesn't have to be anything more than that. And that is truly liberating.
Yeah. Yeah. And then to be able to offer that to somebody else, because once you've seen, like, once I see things about myself and I'm accountable, and go, it was an innocent mistake.
Yes.
I'm not trying to not do something right. You're doing your best and you see it's an innocent mistake. So then when somebody else makes a mistake and you don't hold it against them and they're like, well, I thought you'd be upset.
Right.
Why would I be upset? Because I've seen now.
Yes.
So it's yep. nice to be able to extend that kind of love to other people in circumstances where they would really be infuriated by their story.
Right.
Oh, I'm so guilty. I'm such a failure. Or, that's not what I'm saying. Because right. I understand. It's
yeah.
just an innocent mistake. It's not yeah. a big deal. We'll fix it. We'll move past this. You know,
right.
whatever.
Right. And it's yeah. it's a beautiful experience when someone is used to receiving, you know, judgment from mm-hmm. you. And then all of a sudden one day it's just not there. And they don't know how to take it. Like, they don't know what to do with it. They're like, aren't you mad? No. Yeah. No, I'm really not. And then they still will work to beat themselves up mm-hmm. because they have no concept that it's just not necessary, you know. And I've had people in my personal life where something like that has happened and I'm like, why are you sitting there all mopey? Why are you beating yourself up? I'm not upset. Why should you be upset? Mm-hmm. It's done. It's over.
Yes.
Gone. This is here. This is now.
Well, now I will say that, you know, that's one of the things, like you were speaking earlier about that all the work is truly internal. Like, you got to do it for yourself, your teacher, guide, guru. Nobody can do it for you. But, you know, you were speaking to that before. But I think that it was good for me because as a teacher, I got to see an example. You were the example for me of, like, when I would come to you and say, I'd done this horrible thing, or I really hurt somebody, or I acted in a really crappy, like, ugly mm-hmm. way. And I could see you being the example of how that should, I'm not going to word this right. Like, I would say these things to you, and you would look at me and go, well, you're so stupid, you're such a failure, why are you so ugly with people? Why,
right.
you know, which is, in the outside world, that's kind of the reaction I was getting from
right.
people I was looking to.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, I was bringing you, like, and I was being very honest with you as my guide, showing you all my ugly parts I didn't want to look for in the first place, but now that they were coming up, and I was seeing how you were handling them and the truth that you were delivering in the face of that.
Right.
And that would make me go home and go, what the hell? I never even considered that perspective. You know what I mean? So
right.
it was very life-altering for me because I didn't have anybody in my life that had a healthy perspective. So that was very life-changing for me because mm-hmm. just seeing how you process things, how you looked at them, and the truth that you would deliver helped me quickly start to turn it back on myself. So that helped my personal inward journey mm-hmm. because then I would look at things myself and instead of going, well, I am a failure, I'm a really ugly person, I'm just so unloving, I'm just, that's all I could see. But then when you were showing me things and mirroring that truth, then it helped speed up how I would look at things because I would go, well, wait a minute. And then I was able to start seeing both sides and start to see the play of mm-hmm. you know, the swing back and forth and the highing and the denial, and I was able to really speed up. So the work is internal, but I think a really enlightened, brilliant teacher who can really stand in the truth and mirror that so powerfully, even when you're in the most ugly places, mm-hmm. and you know that to be you, and they're going, no.
Right.
And they're standing powerfully in that. It's not like they're doing the work for you, but it's brilliant because they're kind of pointing something, and they're kind of pointing so powerfully
yes.
to where it doesn't let you, it doesn't enable you to go polarized into one truth or another truth, mm-hmm. or I'm not even wording it correctly, but it just, I'm not wording it in a way that I want to word it because that's not my strong point. But it's like the truth is so resolute that it helps me stand there a little bit on my own, even if I haven't experienced it yet,
mm-hmm.
so I can kind of really bring more of my story forward and be less afraid of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can go, okay, I was a little more afraid of this, I didn't want to bring this forward, but now I think I can because I feel less afraid because this truth is more powerful mm-hmm. than my story, than all this
right.
stuff I believe to be true.
Right. So, right.
That was very, very helpful, and I had not experienced that in anybody else, and I had done a lot of research. I had searched a lot of paths, a lot of religions, a lot of, you know, atheism, Buddhism. I mean, I was searching for anything to make sense of some stuff for me, and when I would bring you things, that's the first experience I had had of something standing so resolute, so powerfully, and it was so true and so undeniable that it gave me, like, a place where I felt like, that's the truth, then I'm okay.
Mm-hmm.
I can bring all this stuff to the surface, and I'm okay, because if this is not true, and I want to stand there, then it was very empowering, even though I was still in the place where I was in a really crappy place. but in that, I was like, but that's my truth. So, you know, you were pointing me to my truth. And that was very powerful. And I hadn't found that anywhere else. Mm-hmm. It was, I mean, I tried psychiatry. I tried therapy. I went to therapy for a long time. And I was like, well, I can sit and talk to myself for an hour and pay myself $100 an hour. I was like, I love it. Because it was like going round and round. It was round and round and round mm-hmm. and round in my head. And I'm like, going round and round in my head is not helping me so much. You know, because right. there's shit in my head. I don't want to be in my head. So I think that was one of the main things, was I had not had that example to look at before. Mm-hmm. So that helped me tremendously so much. It wasn't just the things you were saying, it was how you were standing in it mm-hmm. that showed me how mm-hmm. how I could trust that when I couldn't trust myself.
Yes, and that is very true. And but let me give you the opposite side. Because the guide has to be all things, and this is something that I speak to with everyone, so when it happens, it doesn't completely take them, you know, by surprise, although it still will. You know, so what Devin is speaking to was where I needed to function with her based on where she was at. And so that's what the guide is there to do with everybody. And it looks different for everybody depending on the part of the journey each person is on. So there are times where the guide is incredibly loving and kind and soft and, you know, that because that's what the person requires at the time. There was a level of trust that had to be built so that you understood that you could come in and actually divulge all these things that you wouldn't dare whisper out loud, much less tell someone about, and know that I wasn't going to judge you, you know, that I would love you unconditionally. So at a point, though, when you move deeper into work where now there are aspects of the personality that are hidden, and I mean hidden, and they come up in your life all the time, but you don't recognize them because every time it comes up, wherever it's coming from, you end up placing the blame on that person or on that circumstance, and you can't see that that's just an unconscious aspect of yourself that you are hiding from yourself because the resistance is so strong, you're too afraid to look at it. So part of what you know, any guide has to do is that at those points where that's the next piece to fall away, the guide has to be, you know, sometimes, how do we say this? Like sometimes the masters will create situations that'll just bring it up for you anyway. But sometimes the guide has to step in and be the one to reflect it. Mm-hmm. So depending on whatever it is, it can not look very good, you know?
No, it feels so good.
I've had people swear at me. I've had all kinds of things happen. I've had people leave altogether, you know, saying there's no way on earth that you could be a master because no master would do that to a person. And I'm laughing going, well, you have no idea, you know, yeah. Because the reality is whatever, if you're here because you want freedom, you're here because you want illumination, enlightenment, whatever you want to call it, if that's why you're here, that to me is sacred. That there's nothing else that trumps that. So whatever you require to get you to that next step is what I'm going to bring, regardless of what it looks like. Because remember, the whole thing about it looking mean or unkind or whatever you want to call it, that's just concept, right? And that's something that the personality wants to hold on to. It's sense of, you know, like people have some concept in their head that Sananda, Jesus, you know, would never do anything that, you know, would never utter a harsh word. Well, obviously you don't know Sananda, right? Because any being is going to appropriately match what's going on in a moment. And I use the Bible for that, right? So Jesus with the money changers in the temple, that wasn't typical behavior for him, right? And yet it was necessary. He had to make a point. Mm-hmm. Now, it didn't mean when it happened that he loved the money changers less. It didn't mean that he judged them personally and held them in judgment. He didn't, not at all. He was far beyond that level of functioning. Mm-hmm. But he made a point that was necessary. Mm-hmm. They needed to see what they were doing. You know, mm-hmm. Now does it mean that they got it? Not necessarily, mm-hmm. But he needed to do what he needed to do. And so it's the same for any person who's functioning at you know, this level of being a quote-unquote spiritual guide, is sometimes you have to do it. And sometimes it, you have to, you know, you run the risk that it's a very fine line. You know, did I build enough trust with them that they'll be able to move through this? Or are they going to turn around and leave? And maybe they do, right? And you don't go chasing after them. You don't, you have to let them walk their walk, right? Because that's the most important thing, period, you know? And, yeah, so I just wanted to say that because so many people come in and they get really, you know, their concept is, if you're a spiritual teacher, you have to be this, you know, my expectation of what, you know, whatever you want to call me, my expectation of what that looks like, you know. And so if you're outside of that, it must mean you're not that. And it's like, no, but it doesn't, because I'm not any of it. Right? I'm not any of it.
And yeah. I had to, I mean, even with you, like in my work, I had to learn that unconditional love does not mean to be enabled.
That's right.
And yeah. I had to uncover that I assumed that unconditional love would always feel good.
Yes.
And always feel loving and always enable me. Now, right. Of course, not consciously enable, like I want you to enable me to keep being in denial.
Right.
But I thought we'd feel good and you'd be gently kind of, you know. But there was a moment when I needed to be kicked in the ass, like, because it was enough.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah.
Because you couldn't see through it. It was so hidden, you couldn't see
and
through
it. And so deep, and it was like there was not a sense of empowerment that I could overcome it.
Yep.
So the unconditional love, while it not doesn't feel to the ego like love.
Right.
In the moment that I could step back, it was the most loving gift ever offered, because I know it wasn't easy for the other either, from a loving standpoint. But so then seeing that opens the heart even further for me. That's what it did, because I was like, wow, I've misunderstood even unconditional love. So then I looked at, I say I love my children unconditionally. So then I started really looking at, so it did really speed up my whole process, because it's like there was like this last little piece I was afraid to look at, and I was like, I'm not afraid. It ain't gonna be good. It ain't gonna be pretty. It's not gonna feel great. It's good, but I'm not afraid.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that felt really good. That was like true liberation. When I'm not saying I'm gonna overcome it and be like a master tomorrow. I'm not saying that, but I just wasn't afraid.
Yes.
I'm like, it may feel like it's gonna eat me alive, but I'm not afraid.
Yeah.
And that felt really good, because I had not ever felt that in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a beautiful gift. Mm-hmm. So now I'm like, I could be homeless tomorrow, because I don't know what life's going to bring. I'm going to be okay. No matter what it looks like, it may not feel good. It may really feel
right.
devastating, you know?
Yeah.
But so that felt really loving. Like, I was like, that's such a beautiful gift to have, you know, and to give that, to have somebody give it. So I thank you for all that you've given me. You've kind of run the gamut for me.
Yes.
Being the gentle, loving person I could cry to, because I had nobody else to, you know, and there was the trust factor, and I explicitly trust you, but you've also taught me to trust myself.
Yes.
And to really go there first, and to build that. There's just so many benefits to, I mean, you know, if anybody ever had questions, you could ask any of the students or Shusara, because everybody's experience has been very different, yet very beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
There's just so many benefits to the life here. And then being, reminded of who we truly are, which we sometimes forget so much that even when you say it, we're like, no, that's ridiculous. You know? I don't know what you're talking about. That's like sci-fi. You know? I think this has been good, because this feels really good, what we've talked about today.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know, even talking to my friends sometimes at work or different places, there seems to be fear. There's a lot of fear still in people. I'm afraid to go in there and find what's there. I'm just handling life as it is, and life's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I'm like, oh, if you could just get a glimpse of what I was before and how I feel now, you'd be like, it's completely worth it.
Yeah, and that's the challenge. Boy, do I understand that, you know, and especially from where I stand, when I watch people who are working with me, where I can see the next step, and I'm like, oh, if you would just push a little harder, you know, but people will do what they're going to do, and you have to allow them to do that. You know, you can encourage them or do things like that, but even at a certain point, at a certain point, it has to be completely left to the person. And I'll even stop encouraging. I would stop, you know, communicating, period, because there's a level, and remember this, any of you, regardless of kind of where you're sitting, there's a level for every seeker where the seeker has to recognize that it's up to them to reach. You know, the guide isn't there to do your work for you. They're there to kind of be your rudder, to help you get your course realigned when you're way off track. But you have to do the realignment, you know. And there are times where, a lot of seekers have experiences with, I can't speak to them specifically because it wouldn't be right, but there are so many times where a seeker will have an experience with a guide and it's so challenging for them that they can't in that moment go past it. And for some of them, it'll take them a couple weeks to get to. For some of them, they never will. They'll end up, you know, like I've said before, kind of leaving and not coming back. And it's such a, for me, I've had experiences where that has happened. I've watched students who were very serious about doing dissolution work, and I've watched them leave and make it like final. And it's been really painful. Because not personally, it's hard to explain, it's not personal, but what you recognize is the missed opportunity, you know, for them. And it's so painful to experience that you could see the potential, you could see where the person was heading, and you could see where they were falling short and where they just weren't quite fearless enough or quite committed enough or whatever the word is you want to use. And then they drop it and they cut you off and walk away. And that's certainly their choice. I won't chase anybody down. But it doesn't mean it doesn't hurt to watch it happen, because, you know, you recognize, oh my word, honey, if you had just stuck it out today, you would be sitting in a completely different place, you know. And that is challenging to watch. And it does happen. But just know, too, that if you've had that experience with any, with a teacher that maybe you've had or something, and you can recognize after the fact that, wow, what they did was actually in my best interest. It's up to you to reach for them now, because universal law dictates, and any teacher worth the salt functions from this, I can't impose myself on your free will. I can't, nor would I want to. So if you've chosen to leave and you've said, I'm done, well, then fine, be done, right? It doesn't mean that I cut you off if you cut me off. But it doesn't mean, too, that the door is wide open either. Because at that point, you have to show your own commitment to your work. And you do that through that reach, you know. I've known guides who, I've watched different students reaching for guides, and they won't respond. They're waiting. You know, how serious are you? And at a certain point, someone, you know, you've all heard stories about people where I was so determined to go to this, to see, you know, Sai Baba or whatever, that I went to the ashram and I did all this stuff and got up at 3 a.m. and, you know, scrubbed floors and all. And that's why, you know, in the East, they do things like that, because the seeker has to prove that they're serious, you know. And here in the West, the way that we function, we've made it, you know, especially with our particular organization, we're so unusual from the stance of what people would expect, mm-hmm. from, you know, hardcore spiritual work. And we don't fit into a box. We absolutely do not fit into any box that you could think of. And that's very challenging for people, because if you come looking for, oh, so you deal with the knowledge from the Upanishads, and I come from a Hindu background, or I come from Buddhist understandings, I have an expectation of how I'm going to function, I'm not going to fit into your expectation, you know, and it really kind of freaks people out. but it's such a beautiful thing, because your guide needs to be all of it for you. And that's the reality of it. So if you're in resistance to having your teacher be stern, let's say, then that's something you need to work on, right? Because, I mean, well, what was Sri Yukteswar, you know, for Yogananda. Yeah. I mean, the whole time that, if you know the story, Yogananda's story, I mean, the whole time he was with him, I mean, for him to get the slightest little piece of something that was, you know, that seemed like love from his guru, was for praise, yeah, was like, you know, this huge thing. But Sri Yukteswar loved him so very much. But he functioned where he needed to function from, because it was for Yogananda's best interest, mm-hmm. you know. And that's the thing, that the guide isn't a personality. The guide is not a personality. And the seeker wants to tag a personality onto them.
Because that's all you understand as a seeker. You don't understand anything outside of personality.
So right.
You're just reaching for what you think you can relate to.
Right, right, right. Yeah. Yeah.
But it's not there. You're like, I'm trying to understand you, but I don't understand you.
I know. I've had students that have just been so confused by me. They're like, you don't make any sense. And I just laugh.
You know. I don't get you at all.
Yeah. It's good. So if there's any questions about coming off of this video, I guess, about the work that we do or
anything. Any questions. If anybody has any question, it'd be great if you could post it and we could have Shusara answer your question next interview. Or if you have any comments, things you're thinking of or you would like for her to talk about, any topics, we'd love for people to post it so we can get an idea of what people want to hear about, what they'd like to hear approach, talk about.
Yeah, I think this is a wonderful platform to be able to kind of reach out and touch people in a way that I can't in just, you know, being kind of stuck in one location. Although we do, and I guess I should probably say it on here, we do have a weekly satsang session that goes out live on bbsradio.com every Thursday night, Eastern Time, 9 to 10. And that's on Station 1 on BBS Radio. And that is a beautiful thing. Through that, you can get to our archives as well. We've been doing those for 2.5 years or so. Mm-hmm. And or through our website at kumaracenter.org. You can, through the media, I think it's the media tab, you can find the archives and download them right to your iPod or your computer or whatever to listen to whenever you want. And they're very valuable to just go. I have students today who have been with me 5 years, and at work they're listening to archives like all day long, you know. And there's something to be said for that when you have really pure information coming through. It's a beautiful thing to just keep it flooding your awareness all the time, because the world is incredibly seductive. It's very easy to just fall into the level of the world. And remember I said right at the beginning how I have to deal with people on both levels, you know, but this piece is so important, because if I'm not constantly bringing higher truth to them, it's just too hard to hold it on your own, you know. And that's what those archives are beautiful for. So feel free to check us out there. It's called Satsang with Shusara.
And check out all the events we're getting ready to add to the calendar for the new moon meditations that we'll be doing locally.
Yep.
And the full moon meditations. Those are going to be really powerful, really cool. Mm-hmm. So those are getting ready to go up on the calendar. Mm-hmm. So check the website for information on that, kumaracenter.org. Mm-hmm. Anything I've forgotten?
I don't think so.
Okay. Until next time.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.